Hello, my name is Caroline Jones, and I'm pre-recording this to welcome you to the MIT Open House. I'm first starting with my discipline group, which is History, Theory, and Criticism. This is, we're very proud of this group. It's the first PhD program that was ever founded in an architecture department inside a School of Architecture and Planning. I think the phrase that best describes our work is rigorous interdisciplinarity. So I'm showing you here my wonderful colleagues, Nasser Rabat, the Aga Khan Professor of Islamic Art and Architecture, Timothy Hyde, Lauren Jacoby, both of them are on leave this year. Arindam Dutta, with whom I've taught, we developed a course called Technopolitics, which is still in the MArch curriculum. Crystal Cementak, currently the head of HTC, and Mark Jerzombek, a senior architectural historian. One postdoc, Will Lockett, is here. He's a media theorist of computation and design and is currently teaching in our group, courtesy of the Mellon and the Center for Arts, Science, and Technology, which you'll hear more about later. Okay, so what happened to me at MIT? That's kind of a good question for telling you what would happen to you if you joined us in our intellectual and practical adventures. So I was a scholar, I am a scholar of post-war American art, and I was particularly interested in the practice of Jackson Pollock and his relationship with the determining critic of post-war US modernism, Clement Greenberg. The result was this book, Eyesight Alone, which existed in manuscript form when I joined MIT, but was radically reconfigured as I began to push on this question of technoscience and its interface with artists. I became aware, for example, of the MIT graduate, Gijon Miele, whose work in graphicalizing gesture was a powerful popular cultural iconography in the post-war period. So this photograph of housewives changing a bed in the most efficient way possible was published in Life magazine, and it was certainly seen by Jackson Pollock when he was making his breakthrough gestures, the graphicalized gestures of his famous skein paintings. So this is just one instance that got me, being at MIT, got me thinking about the graphic gesture as a techno-scientific achievement as well as a cultural one. Being at MIT, I wanted to get involved with the List Visual Arts Center. And in 2006, 2007, I was part of a curatorial team that did an incredibly fun exhibition that we called Sensorium. The catalog, which I edited, was called Embodied Experience, Technology and Contemporary Art. The cover image is by the architect François Roche. The most fun part for me of doing this catalog was inventing an abecedarius, which alphabetically clustered a bunch of random terms that I got really cool people like Bruno Latour and Donna Haraway to write about for the catalog. And I think the most fun of these abecedarius entries was the last one here, Zoon, or Zoon, if you want to pronounce it in a more Greek apposite way. I managed to get Donna Haraway to collaborate with me in an exchange about this word, which simply means kind of living critter, living creature. And Donna's metaphor for that were the colonial tunicates, which physiologically connect themselves together, separate species, separate organisms that can be said to form kinships as they colonize marine surfaces. And we're gonna come back to this because it's now very much a part of my current research, which I'll tell you more about later. Okay, so coming out of Sensorium, which had this phrase in the title of embodied experience, I then began to ask myself, well, wait a minute, whose experience, right? The emergence of difference in how experiences are codified in very different bodies, very different cultural paths, right? This became a burning issue for me, particularly since around that time, exhibitions were completely obsessed with the idea of experience, right? And I'm showing you here Mariko Mori's Wave UFO, which posits a kind of neurological slash Buddhist, you know, universalizing of human brains. So this became a really interesting question for me, and I began to get back in time, back into the history of art that tried, as in Marcel Duchamp, to defeat the spectacle and to open out onto what I began to call a blind epistemology. So these devices of Duchamp's were posited as anti-retinal, right? As somehow defeating the spectacularized vision of 20th century modernity, which I traced even further back for this book, The Global Work of Art, looking at where Duchamp actually exhibited these devices. And the surprising answer is in an inventor's fair in the outside of Paris. I'm showing you here a much earlier Hall of Machines at the Paris World's Fair of 1900, but this was the kind of thing that I realized had a powerful impact on the artists of the 20th century. And that became the focus of this book on the global work of art. How does art work on us? What does it work with in its time? So again, this could only have happened to me at MIT as I became much more interested in the urbanist context of these world's fairs as they fed into the biennials of the 20th century and the 21st century. Okay, so, you know, following the trail of experience, I got involved in this interesting group. It's called CAST for short. Everything at MIT becomes an acronym. CAST stands for the Center for Art, Science, and Technology, which, you know, pretty much describes everything I'm interested in this world and in this history. So I got involved with them in doing a kind of an interrogation of experience on the grounds of sensory knowledge, sensory knowing. So we crafted a symposium called Seeing, Sounding, Sensing. The actual program that you're seeing here was for the Sensing Day. And I invited people that I knew and admired, like Bruno Latour, but also neuroscientists to speak with artists. This is Bevel Conway, to speak with artists like Taube Auerbach on the far right, and the history of science scholar Alma Steingart, all of whom interrogated the seeing of color, which is a highly cultural and body-specific phenomenon, even though we all have the same equipment. How could a symposium on sensory experience possibly be cemented in a book? This was the challenge that we faced following this event. And I began to work with people like Thomas Saraceno. This is me visiting his studio and trying to sew some spider webs. We were experimenting with the idea of having unique sewn pages in the catalog. Well, we had to give that up. But what we ended up with was this fabulous spider web print with the bindings of the book became these kind of elaborate bookmarks that were kind of spider threads that would be thrown out at you. The other artist commission in the book is this wonderful optical illusion, which is actually printed in the book with pheromone scented ink, so that the front is male and the back of the end pages is female, and you have to decide which one is more attractive to you. It might be the other way around. Right, you know, so just experiment with that. The final resulting cover is the commission by Olafur Eliasson, who chose to have heat sensitive ink as a way that it would be printed in black, and you would actually reveal Olafur's drawing with the heat and pressure of the human hand. So this was a lot of fun to try and make experiences that were only available in the form of a printed book. The experiment with doing symposia with CAST has been so fun that we're just now doing another one. So by the time you see this recorded introduction to what I do, it'll be the beginning of this symposium, Unfolding Intelligence. My session is split in two because the first two participants are in Berlin and the second two are in Canada. So in the morning, we'll be hearing from Jenna Sutla, a Finnish artist living in Berlin who does fantastically interesting interrogations of creaturely intelligence and alien AI as alien intelligence. She'll be speaking with Lars Bang Larsen, a global curator who gets the best work out of all of us. And in the afternoon, we'll be hearing from Jason Edwards Lewis, who is a fantastic indigenous epistemologist and creative coder. And he'll be talking about kinship with the biologist of mutualism, Megan Fredrickson, who has a very different idea of thinking about mutualisms in the open systems of Earth. So this is going to be a lot of fun. I really hope that you'll have a chance to join us in that event. My work in my own research has gotten very involved with questions of the bios, questions of biological material as it enters the art world and it enters our mentality at this point in the Anthropocene when we feel so divorced from other forms of life that share the planet with us. I found it extremely helpful to think with the work of Annika Yee, whom I got involved with when she was a visiting artist at MIT. This is a detail from her installation at the Guggenheim, and I wrote for that catalog. With Annika's thinking, I generated the concept of biofiction and the concept that I'm now plumping symbiontics. In other words, symbiosis is that which is. This is my new polemic, and it's a utopian project. As soon as we can accept the fact that we are completely entangled with and dependent on other forms of life, the sooner we'll be able to revise our toxic individualism and we'll be able to better partner with the life forms that we're dependent upon on the planet. So this brings me to the seed planted in Sensorium, gosh, I guess about 15 years ago in that exchange I had with Donna Haraway. Haraway had brought this idea of the colonial tunicate to our exchange about zoons, and in particular, her conclusion brought us back to a very important use of that word, Aristotle's zoon politikon, to describe the human creature as a creature of politics. So with Donna's help in the back of my mind, I'm coming up with this polemic symbiontics, and it's going to be a driver for this exhibition that I'm planning for the list in the fall of 2022, titled Symbionts, Contemporary Artists and the Biosphere. So, the idea here is just to entice you with all the things that are going on at MIT. Bureaucratically, I'm also an associate dean of some kind in the school, at the school level. And in that capacity, I'm director of this entity called the Transmedia Storytelling Initiative. And you should know about this because it's so far been possible for us to give grants to student work in all kinds of spatialized alternative media. And we also like to sponsor events, the first of which last fall was Data Magic and Democracy. And we interrogated just, less than a week before the election, the theft of personal data from Facebook in order to try to craft a particular political outcome in the previous electoral process. The event that will have happened last night before this open house is coming up for me as I record this, and that is 3D 5G, a look at surveillance and agency in the world of new media. So thank you for your attention, and I really hope you come to MIT, and it's going to be fun to encounter you when you do. Thank you, and goodbye.